Hello, everybody. Scott Golden here with the NXT review series. Do not confuse AEW and NXT. These are very different products. Here on Pro Wrestling Logic, and this is the November 9th, 2021 edition. Toxic Attraction defeating Casey Catanzaro, Caden Carter, and Io Shirai 1250. Fun little match, fun opener to the program, and starts with a match instead of a promo, which is a good thing. Wish they would do that more often. Mandy Rose gains an early advantage for her tandem after knocking Shirai off the apron. Heels are in control and cut Carter off from the team, isolate her on their side of the ring. JC Jane catches Carter with a neck breaker and gets a near fall as a result. Follows up with an enziguri, but Carter recovers and tags in Io Shirai. Shirai then hits a standing moonsault into a double knee for two count, and then Catanzaro hits a slingshot tenton on Jane for a near fall, but heels back her into the corner, and Catanzaro recovers and hits a dive to the floor on Rose. Catanzaro then hits a crossbody onto Gigi Dolan, and Jane Shirai then goes for a dive, but Rose cuts her off and takes over a bit during the break. Shirai then catches Dolan with a crossface. Heels take over and isolate Catanzaro in their corner for a good bit. Come back for the break. Heels are in control, and then Catanzaro breaks free finally. Shirai gets the hot tag, goes nuts on Dolan and stomping her in the corner. Shirai gets her hands on Rose and hits a running double knee in the corner. Follows up with a moonsault on Rose for a very close near fall. And then the heels take over once again. Carter rolls through and then rocks Dolan with a super kick. Fans are into this. They're into this as much as a This Is Awesome chant will allow. Carter then climbs the top rope, but Jane jumps on the apron and distracts Catanzaro and Shirai, and attacking Rose, and then Jane at ringside. Dolan then yanks Carter off the top rope and hits her finisher for the win. After the match, Toxic Attraction poses on the stage with the championships and into the back. Mackenzie Mitchell interviews Pete Dunne. She asked about Tony D'Angelo's comments last week. Dunne then tells D'Angelo to come find him. Toxic Attraction also then comes back, and they're on the stage. Kaylee Ray music hits, and she makes her way to the ring, passing by Toxic Attraction in the process. MSK continues their journey. They've been walking a long time, and they are joining in with still having no direction, like many of the talents in WWE in general. Kaylee Ray defeats Savai in 451. Ray and Savai have a good, short enough match, but it is what it is. Ray then jumps Shirai at the bell and then beats her down. Shirai then fights back with arm drags and hits a double foot stomp for her trouble, rocking Ray with forearm, but Ray fires back with a series of forearms for her own trouble and keeps things going. Ray then misses splash in the corner, and Ray hits DDT for a close two count. Shirai follows up with a near fall and then goes into a half crab. Ray fights back and makes it to the ropes for trouble, gets a break of the hold in the process. Ray then rocks Shirai with a super kick, but Shirai fires back with a kick to the head for trouble, and then Shirai misses dropkick, and Ray sends her to the floor. Ray then hits a KLR bomb on the announce table and hits a second one in the ring for the win. It is what it is. I don't know that either one of these talents is, they really have a plan for, and wouldn't be surprised to see either one on a cut list going backwards. In the back, Joe Gacy discusses his upcoming match with Boa. He thinks Boa feels that he has to hide who he really is. They show highlights of Braun Breaker competing in the UK tour and promising to win the NXT title, which basically guarantees it'll happen at some point. They didn't get a lot of time, and they had a weak finish here. DQ finish, continuing a match that, or a feud that doesn't need to be continued. Boa has the early advantage, but in a 3-minute match, how early can it be? Gacy takes over. Gacy hits a side slam and a suplex for his trouble. Boa fires back and hits knees. Lights go out. Boa attacks Gacy against the ropes, and Boa refuses to break the hold, gets disqualified. Gacy laughs in the camera and acted like he planned this as some mastermind plan. Why would you plan a disqualification victory if that's your plan? Anyway, they show up. Jacked time promo. Diamond Mind is watching the promo, and they are trained. Malcolm Bivens demands that Creed Brothers defeat Jacked Times tonight. In the back, Mackenzie Mitchell tries to interview Solo Sikoa, but Grayson Waller and LA Knight interrupt, and Sikoa challenged both of them to a match later. So, hooray and hooray, we have a three-way. The Creed Brothers with Diamond Mind defeat Jacked Time, 7:42, longer than it needs to be. Fans seem to enjoy the match, though. Kushida is the highlight of the match. Creed Brothers gained an early advantage isolating Kushida in their corner. Kushida, though, fights back and hits a double handspring elbow on the heels. Ikemen Juro and Kushida then regain control and knock Creed Brothers off the apron. Jack Time posed in the middle of the ring before commercial break. Back from the break, Kushida then runs wild and scores a near fall. Kushida and Juro hit a double drop kick on the Creed Brothers. Juro eventually tries to fight back after being dominated for several minutes. Roderick Strong interferes and Julius hits a gut wrench powerbomb to win for the Creed Brothers. Post match, Odyssey Jones runs out for the save and attacks the Diamond Mine. So apparently we're going in that direction. Toxic Attraction, they're back again, are in the parking lot bragging about being champions. Rose noted that there's nobody worthy of challenging her for the title. Suddenly Raquel Gonzalez drives up on her motorbike and she told Rose to keep the belt warm. And she drives to the ring. Raquel Gonzalez and Dakota Kai have a segment to follow. And basically what that amounts to is Gonzalez jumping up in the ring and repeated to Rose to keep the belt warm. She's going to deal with Dakota Kai first and then is coming for her title to be regained. She then demands Kai come to the ring and Kai slowly walks and talked about how good it felt to her to be back with everything at Halloween Havoc. Suddenly, Cora Jade runs out, attacks Kai. Gonzalez gets in Jade's face and notes that she gets to face Kai first. Adam Chase has a seminar at Chase University that discussed mental toughness until he yelled at one of his students and kicked him out. Cameron Grimes defeats Ru Fang, not exactly a super talent here. At this point, the show starts to drag because almost there's too many segments, I guess you'd say, and it feels like it's going on longer than it has. Cameron Grimes is squashing things, and then as a showcase for Grimes, he looks good enough in the match, but is lacking the story that he had months ago with the million-dollar belt situation. Grimes has an early advantage and mocks Fang. Fang fights back and slows the pace of the match down a little bit. Abdominal stretch is how he gets there from here. Grimes then fights back for the hip toss. Grimes then fires up, runs wild on Fang. He rocks Fang with a running boot and is in the corner. Grimes then follows up with a flying crossbody for near fall, hits a double foot stomp for the win, and after the match, Duke Hudson comes out to the ring, gets in Grimes' face, demands to know if Grimes called him a hick, and Grimes mocks Hudson, brags about winning, and Hudson then promised that he'd never lose again to someone that looks like a rotten troll. So very cutting edge comedy here. Grimes wondered why Hudson had to repeat name, resort to name calling, and Grimes pronounces everything a little differently. Triple threat match, Sokoa defeating Gracie Waller and LA Knight, 5 minutes for this. Fine triple threat, but didn't get a lot of time, nor did it really need to happen. Waller and Knight argued with each other until Sokoa makes his way. Waller charges Sokoa, but that doesn't lead very well. Waller and Knight then work together for a little bit to beat down Sokoa. Fans break into an LA Sucks chant, and Waller and Knight argue about who's going to take over on Sokoa. Sokoa misses a splash in the corner, and Knight hits a neckbreaker for his trouble taking over. Waller then attacks Knight with knees, and then kind of things come back around. Sokoa hits a super kick, then finishes coming off. Sokoa then throws Waller out of the ring with a belly-to-belly suplex, and then hits a splash on Knight for the win. Electra Lopez and Legado del Fantasma are on their way to the ring. Lopez hopes that Zion Quinn is watching. Electra Lopez with Legado del Fantasma defeats Erica Yan, 123, quick squash, and it was probably still too long at less than 2 minutes. Yan tries to jump Lopez at the bell, doesn't get anywhere. Lopez takes over and slaps across the face, hits a suplex, follows up with a sit-out powerbomb that did not look good for the victory. After the match, Lopez calls out Zion Quinn, and then offers him a spot in Legado del Fantasma. Quinn turned down the offer. Well, Mendoza and Joaquin Wild tried to stop Quinn, but fights back. Quinn then clears the ring and has a intense stare down with Lopez. They announce War Games for December 5th. The event is only called War Games with no reference to the TakeOver name. In the back, Mackenzie Mitchell interviews Kyle O'Reilly. He says he's not sure if he should focus on singles career or go with Von Wagner as a tag team. Imperium approached O'Reilly until Wagner shows up, and that's that. Then we go to our, I guess, main event segment, non-title match. Pete Dunne defeating North American champion Carmelo Hayes with Trick Williams in 12-12. Dunne and Hayes have a good match, fast-paced, not a big surprise there. Dunne good with just about anybody. Dunne rocks Hayes with a forearm, and that's right at the opening bell. Dunne then follows up with a clothesline, and then slows the pace down a little bit, works over Hayes, and then targets the fingers. Hayes then fights back with a kick to the face and springboard clothesline off the middle rope for his trouble. Hayes then takes over and kicks Dunne in the arm. Dunne then recovers and rocks Hayes with a kick to the arm as well. Dunne and Hayes are on the apron and snaps fingers. Then they fight to the floor. Hayes attempts a suplex with Dunne reversing, and the suplex of his own is what he gets. Back from the break, Dunne then manages to ignore the fact that Dexter Lumis is on commentary. That happened. Hayes hits a huge codebreaker to take over. Follows up with clotheslines. Dunne then tries fighting back, but Hayes slams him down for another near fall. Dunne then fires back with a hard forearm and a sit-out powerbomb for the very close two count. Fans break this down. This is awesome chant. There we go. Hayes then leaps over the ropes, but Dunne then rocks him with a hard forearm. Hayes then fights back with a twisting suplex for another near fall. Fans then break into NXT and fight forever chants. Why they're doing this, I have no idea. Hayes locks on the Gargano escape, but Dunne breaks free, attacking the fingers. Fans break into another "This is awesome" chant. I do not understand these fans. Dunne then hits a release German suplex and knocks Williams off the apron. Dunne then walks from the bitter end, but Hayes then shoves him into the middle rope. Loomis attacks Williams at ringside, and That's before he could attack Dunn in the ring. Hayes backs up against the ropes and a hand appears from under the ring. Hayes backs up and the hand grabs his leg. Dunn takes advantage and hits the bitter end for the win. Post-match, Johnny Gargano appears under the ring and gives a thumbs up to Loomis. Dunn then looks at Loomis and Gargano and gives each other the thumbs up to end the NXT show. Cameron Grimes takes on Duke Hudson next week in a poker showdown. Six-man tag team match, Odyssey Jones and Jack Time take on the Diamond Mine, Roderick Strong, and the Creed Brothers. Plus, Dexter Lumis goes one-on-one with Tony D'Angelo next week. And that's NXT. I do not know why anyone would watch this show willingly, but it's here, and people apparently do. In any event, we'll be back with more right after this.